As a tutor for Champion Learning Center, I have to say my most challenging student that I tutored was a kindergartner. And he was challenging not only because of, you know, the fact that he's a kindergartner, that I have to, you know, his attention span is so much significantly smaller than all the other students, and I still have to tutor him 2 hours at a time. Even just doing, like, even trying to getting to engage him to be engage into the material for an hour or so would be hard enough. For 2 hours, that's challenging in itself, you know, and there's just so much to learn. And to teach, you know, maybe the kindergartner that I dealt with didn't know how to read. So totally teaching someone alphabets from that on to helping that person learn how to read, that's a challenging feat in itself. So just tutoring a kindergartner would be challenging enough. But then another layer challenges the fact that he is resistant. So the first time, this was actually the first student I've come to tutor through the company, the very first student. You know, I was kind of dressed up. I had my tie on. I had my shirt. And I wanted to look professional because my deal is, to my students, I really want to look like I'm doing the best for them and establishing this respectful relationship. So that's why I kind of, you know, dress professionally when I go to tutor the students, even though I'm not required to. The only dress code that I must adhere to is that I wear a collared shirt, you know, but collared shirt. And pretty much I can even wear jeans to my work, but I don't. But in any case, I went, he saw me, he freaked. He freaked out. He's like, what? You know, I don't think he's ever had a person, another stranger like me in his home. So he freaked. Then the reason he freaked, it turns out, is because I'm wearing a suit, I'm Asian, and I got my tie. He thought I was a doctor. And they had just come back from the hospital. So, he had just taken, you know, he had just gotten, like, examined. You know, he's just got a physical examination, whatever. He thought I was a doctor that had come back from the hospital to give him a shot, and he hates shots. So that was a very bad first impression for that student. And he freaked, you know. So the first 40 minutes, he was crying in his mom's lap. He's like, no, no, no. It's like, and the mom just like, you know, we try to do the material. And I'm just like, do I have to go back home, like home, schedule another time to do it? So this is the kind of resistance that I start out with. You know, he would be crying for 40 minutes, not willing to do anything, and trying to engage him. And it's been such a challenge tutoring this student. Of course, over the course of tutoring him, I developed many strategies, you know, which turned out to be kind of effective. But a lot of times there's still a lot of resistance hanging in the air. So the resistance about the whole doctor thing, of course, that was a one-time thing. After that, I didn't wear ties whenever I went to his place. And I dressed a little bit more casually when I went there just to establish that I wasn't somebody intimidating, but I was actually kind of someone who he should friend. Still a stranger, but still being there for on his behalf, for his well-being. So kind of got that dress code issue out of the way. And but the big thing was, he learned well in kindergarten, but when he came back home, you know, he had his DS, right? And he would just play his DS pretty much all day. And the parents didn't agree to get him to DS. It's just that his grandma bought him for him without the parents' consent. So because of that, he's hooked to his DS. So he plays the games all day, and when I come, I interrupt his DS playtime, which is the problem. So he wants to continue playing or watch TV or do whatever he does, but instead he has to do something. So it wasn't necessarily a problem with me, but the problem that he had to do to learn and to do something that was not as fun or distracting as a DS. So that was the deal, right? So in order to motivate him, I had to really try hard. I actually spent some money, a good amount of money out of my pocket, just because the system I developed was a reward system. You know, every time he works with me and does good, I put a sticker. You know, I put today's date and I put a sticker, and certain amount of stickers he gets, I give him a present, and so that's where my money comes in. So that kind of motivated him, especially when I said, you know, the final gift I give you, which if you get, like, I think I said 35 stickers, if you get 35 stickers from me, you know, you will get a DS game. So, you know, I actually am totally against. Now I learned through that experience, handheld portable gaming devices are totally not meant for kids. You know, maybe they're totally not meant for kids that age. Maybe like, I don't know, 10, 11, 12, maybe. But if I was a parent, that would still be kind of a no. Maybe, but kindergartners, total no-no. It's just the fact that they're not able to balance their playtime that well. If it's on the TV, the parent could just turn off the TV to unplug the console, that'd be it. With the DS, the kids have constant access to it. So that creates a problem. You know, they could be playing it while in their bed when they're supposed to be sleeping, and the parents wouldn't be even knowing it because he has it on. So anyway, that's my whole beef with the DS thingy. But that was the kind of the system I came up with. There was still a good amount of resistance to it, but in a way, in a lot of sense, I'm kind of disappointed about not being able to really, make him as engaged as I wanted it to be to the material. But at the same time, I'm kind of proud that I actually was able to work around this resistance and have him learn a lot. He did learn a lot through me. You know, when I first met him, he didn't know the alphabet that well. Now he can write his name. You know, that I think that's something I can be proud of, to know that I was a big force in him being able to write his name, and also to read up to 5-letter words. He can now read 5-letter words. It takes him some time. He'll really struggle with reading it, but he can read it, which is, I think, is fantastic. He could actually 3-letter words such as 1, 2, 3, 4. He could kind of write. So he can actually write numbers now. The first time I met him, he didn't know how to do that at all. He knows numbers. He knows the meaning of addition and subtraction, which was a huge effort for me. So being able to do this all in 30 hours of tutoring for me was a humongous success. I feel disappointed that I wasn't able to teach him as much as I wanted it to, but I think given his resistance, it was kind of hard to work around that. Anyway. The point I really wanted to bring up in this video was the final day of tutoring him, and I didn't know why I didn't think of this sooner, because I know he likes being engaged with the DS, right? And he's learning the English language. I don't know why I didn't think of this sooner. A month before the final day, or 3 weeks or so, I bought Super Scribblenauts. It was really cheap. So, and I always wanted to try the game. And Super Scribblenauts is the game that where you type, you put in the word, and the word comes to life, and you can interact it and within the video game. And it's a DS game, so I bought it for myself back then. But then, and then that last day, I was like thinking, wait, I could use this game to teach the kindergartner. That'd be amazing. So I took it, and usually when I arrive to his home, he'll be crying, you know, he'll be hiding, and the parent would be trying all sorts of things to get him to sit at the table, and so he'd be crying for like 30 minutes, at least 30 minutes, just crying, and I'll be trying to get him to work with me. I'll be like, here's the pen, you know, and I'll try to start with an activity that's not related to learning, like coloring, or connecting, I don't know, some kind of play activity, just so that learning can be fun to him in a way, but connect him, but it's been tough. That day, I came in, and he's like, all right, hey, and I kind of announced, he's hiding in his room, way out there, but I just announced, I was like, today I think we're just going to play a DS game. He comes running out, seriously. He comes running out, he's not crying, he's actually smiling, and he's like, what game are we playing? So, using Scribblenauts to teach him how to read was totally successful in that last section. There was of course still a lot of resistance because he got stuck on you know, trying to write words. He's still not able to read or write that properly. So when he's thinking too much and he's getting tired of thinking, he just gave up kind of writing words or trying to spell words and just like ran around, made the character run around and didn't really do what was the material. But that 2 hours was totally productive. And, you know, I really think maybe in that sense, DS was not such a bad idea after all, because it teaches him how to read and write. So who knew, like, the Super Scribblenauts was a game that I was really loving, wanting to play. Because I thought it was going to be one awesome, innovative game. I mean, it's really innovative for the industry as a whole. And I just love unique, quirky concepts like that. And I played the spiritual prequel, Drawn to Life. And I actually really liked that game. And that's the game made by the same company. So it was for me, but it turns out, it turned out to be a great learning tool for the student I tutored, which is surprising.